help us through these next weeks as a congregation, as a people. In Christ's name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. We're going to stop the feed and start it again in the right format. Hold on just a second. Are we good now? I'm Kevin Dick, and welcome to today's service. Let's get the elephant out of the room. This is really weird to speak to an empty church, and yet we know our church is gathered all around us in North Muskegon. So why are we doing this? First, let me say we're not doing it out of fear, and it's not because we're out of toilet paper. We're doing it because we care, and we want to make sure that we're not exposing one another to this virus and that we don't overwhelm our healthcare system by everybody getting sick. So bear with us. It looks like it's going to be about 3 weeks like this, and we're going to have to pull together in different ways. The great advantage to this is we get to be the church the way the church is supposed to be. It's not the building. It's you guys, and you're out in our community, and you get to be the hands and feet of Christ all throughout our area. So we thank you for that. Today we have former pastor here, Reverend Glenn Wagner, who's going to be bringing us a sermon, and we welcome him. Hope you're going to tune into that. And Jeremy had something he wanted to say. We have a video from Jeremy.
Hello, friends. Jeremy here. I'm the pastor of the church, even though I haven't been there for a couple weeks and won't be there for a few more. Thanks so much to Caleb and to Glenn for filling in during this time. They are very kindly following a series of messages that I planned a long time ago, and we have Bible studies accompanying this series called Grow. It's about six essential steps for how to grow as a Christian, how to become what God is calling you to do, how to take advantage of your experience and your insight and become a person fully in ministry and fully committed to Jesus Christ. Friends, after Easter, we're going to have 2 weeks called Membership 101 and 102. I want to make sure you know that you are invited to take part in that. Even if you are already a member of the church, please feel welcome. And what we're going to do is on those two Sundays, there'll be a message giving sort of the basic information about being a member of the church and what the commitment means. And then that's going to be followed by a gathering for conversation at 11, those two Sundays, the 19th and 26th of April, with me. And I'll try to answer all your questions and invite you to join the church. Okay? So God bless you. God fill you with the Holy Spirit this morning in worship, and may you find joy in this community. Hello, friends.
Just as an update,
Jeremy here. I'm the pastor of the church,
Jeremy,
even though I haven't been there for a couple weeks and won't
well
be there for
surgery,
a few more.
But
thanks so much to Caleb and
to the parsonage to visit right now for a variety of reasons, the virus being among them. So, there are ways to reach out to Jeremy. You can use email or text him. And we also have the phone here at the church that you can text to. In fact, that's how we're going to handle prayer requests for the next few weeks. If you have a prayer request, text it to the church phone or to Jeremy. They'll get them compiled and spread out to the prayer chain. As always, our website is a go-to place for any announcements, any bulletins, any postings. You'll find that there. It's communitychurchumc.org is our church website. And also, you can give there. Even though we're not meeting as a congregation, there's still bills coming in. And so you can give by mailing a check to the church, or you can go online to our website, and there's a give button, and you can do it that way electronically. So that's how we're going to keep in touch. And at this point, I'm going to introduce Glenn.
Thank you, Kevin. Hello, community. It is a privilege for me to be here this morning. I'm grateful to be able to return the favor There were times in my ministry when I was physically unable to be present on Sunday morning, and other pastoral colleagues graciously filled in for me, and for that I will be eternally grateful. Someone said, "Won't it be weird to come back to a church to preach to an empty sanctuary?" And the answer is, for me, not really. You see, this is a sacred space for me. When I come in this room where I spent 14 years of my life helping me to raise my family in the love of Jesus Christ, this room now has walls that speak to me every time I'm here. I can't help but look at the choir loft and remember at the time when it was piled high with cans of soup as we collected food for hungry people. I remember prayer meetings where we held hands and fervently prayed for the life of Nick Weller. You remember that, many of you do, and I feel the presence of God just by recalling that event. I remember decorating the church for the holidays with a large community of people to beautify this space, and on Easter when we had a cross filled with lilies to remind us of the love of Jesus Christ and family members that we know and love. I remember baptisms and weddings and funerals, and so I know God is present here, not just on Sunday morning when the church is filled, but whenever two or more are gathered, and two or more of us are gathered physically here and also in spirit online. I hope and pray that you will want to take this link from Facebook and copy it on your email or on your own Facebook feed and share it with others and encourage them to watch in too. It's been quite a week for our country. I remember a few of these times during my lifetime when events happened that were so significant that we resolved at that point never to forget. Some of you may remember, like I do, the death of John Kennedy, who was assassinated on September 11th. I even recall the day my own daughter was born, October 19th, 1987. Some of you may remember, we called it, I think, was it Black Monday? Stock market crash, the NFL strike ended, we bombed Libya, and my daughter was born. And I look back, and those traumatic events are brightened for me because of that other profound memory. This is a time when the church really needs to pull together, because I believe Christian community is needed now more than ever. And so I'm grateful for your willingness to be here this morning. Before I begin, I'd like us to have prayer together. I'll offer a few words, and then I'd like you to join in at home with the Lord's Prayer, if you will. Let us pray. O Lord God, thank you for the privilege of worship and honoring you. We ask your blessing upon this morning, and may my words and our meditations, and most importantly, the response of our hands and our feet and our wills to the hearing of your word this morning, may all these things be acceptable in your sight. And Lord, we pray for Pastor Jeremy, we pray for Tamara, that you may surround them with your care and grace and healing. We pray also for our country and our communities, that you might enable us in this new time and space to honor you and find ways to give witness to your love, because we know the needs will be great. And now, O Lord, we pray humbly as your people, as you've taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, the scripture text that this sermon is based on is the 15th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And if you have access to scripture and you'd like to open it to follow along, if not, I'm going to be telling that story as part of the sermon this morning. Have you got a list? You know what I'm talking about, don't you? A list, like the list that we sing about at Christmas every once in a while. He's making a list. He's checking it twice. Gonna find out who's naughty or nice. You remember that list? Santa Claus, somebody that we revere and honor on an annual basis as being a really good and generous person. Even Santa Claus has a list. Do you have a list? It might not be written down, but do you have a list in your heart or your head of the people that you'd really rather not have over for dinner because they're kind of on your naughty list? A list of people that you'd really be uncomfortable sitting next to in church if they happened to come to church on Sunday morning on a regular basis. And if they did so, you might think about looking for another church just because they're on your list. I know it sounds strange to have a pastor talk about a list like that. When I was a kid growing up, we heard about the love of Jesus and the grace of Jesus and the compassion of Jesus and the forgiveness of Jesus, and it was always delivered on Sunday morning in a really nice surrounding like this one, in a company of really wonderful people who were always good at being nice to each other. But honestly, now that I'm older, I know about those lists. I've got one too. And now that I'm retired and I really don't care what you think, I can share from my own heart that there are people who have lists. Did you know that some of those people who are on the list, there are some of you who have people on your list because you have been married to those folks and now you're not married to them anymore. And sometimes people are on the list because they have abusive behaviors and they're obnoxious, they're terrible to be around. And sometimes those people are on the list because they have developed addictive habits that are really destructive. And so we marginalize people and we put them on our list and hopefully keep some distance between ourselves and them because it just destroys our sense of comfort and well-being. Well, if you've got a list, I want you to know that people in Jesus' day did too. And in the 15th chapter of Luke's Gospel, we're introduced to the people who keep the list. They're described as the scribes and the Pharisees. And those scribes and Pharisees were grumbling because Jesus was eating with tax collectors and sinners. Before you get all to the point where you're writing off the scribes and the Pharisees, let me tell you that in the Bible, those are really good people. The scribes and the Pharisees are the kinds of folks that we'd love to have in our church communities because they take their scripture seriously. They've studied the Bible. They've tried to apply it to their life in a wonderful way, just like I hope all of us will learn about our own Bible and find ways to apply it in practical ways in our lives. And the scribes and Pharisees were upset because Jesus was breaking bread with tax collectors and other sinners. I learned something when I lived in the Middle East for a year, and they take their eating very seriously. And when you break bread with somebody, like we do at communion, it's making a public announcement, taking out a big billboard and saying, "I'm with them, they're with me. And I will do everything that I can to encourage them and uphold them and welcome them and embrace them." And when Jesus is crossing this line to eat with the tax collectors and sinners, it's troubling to the people who are keeping the list for the good of the community, to help protect those folks who want to do well by God. Let me share a word about the tax collectors that the good people were grumbling about that Jesus was eating with. You need to understand that the Jewish people in their history have a deep and profound memory of what it's like to live as slaves. They were slaves for several hundred years in Egypt, and then when they were finally liberated and they spent 40 years wandering in the wilderness before they finally got a land of their own to call their home, they were free for a while, and then in 586 BC they were enslaved again for a generation, and then they finally got out of that slavery and were free again. And then at the time of Jesus, these people were oppressed by the Roman Empire, a military force that not only enforced their rule, but their sometimes oppressive taxes with things like Roman legions and public punishments like crucifixions along the road. And the government, which was the Roman practice in the provinces, they would set up a puppet government and a minority who would be pretty well off, and lots of the other people would be struggling to survive. And the puppet government that was in charge of the region were the family of the Herodians. You remember Herod the Great, who was around when Jesus was born, and then his children who succeeded him. And the Herodians were Edomites. And the Edomites were the descendants, if you're familiar with your biblical genealogy, you'll know that the Edomites were descendants of Esau. And way back in the book of Genesis, there was Isaac and Rebekah had twin sons, Jacob and Esau. Esau was the firstborn, and he was daddy's favorite, and Jacob and Rebekah did some scheming to cheat Esau out of his birthright, and there was a family fracture and tension ever since. You have that in some of your family relationships with some of the in-laws and the outlaws. Well, that family tension exploded in human history in 586 BC when the Babylonians conquered Jerusalem under Nebuchadnezzar, and they took captive these people and enslaved them again. Psalm 137, in the last verse of that psalm, mentions the deep hatred that the Jewish people had for the Edomites, because the Edomites were complicit in the betrayal of Jerusalem and the capture of these people for another generation of slavery. The psalm writes in some of the most venomous verses in the Bible, it says, "Happy of the Edomites, happy shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock." Can you feel that anger at that betrayal and enslavement again? Can you imagine how the Jewish people must have felt about living under Roman rule and ruled by an Edomite king? I don't know about you, but I'd probably put those people on my list. And the tax collectors were collaborators. They were in the employ of this oppressive system, sucking assets out of the community and sending it off to Rome. And if you've ever been to Rome or have the chance to go to Rome, just look around and imagine the wealth and the treasures in that magnificent city and wonder, where did that all come from originally? I understand. There's a part of me that's kind of like the Pharisees and the scribes. I understand why they might get a little upset with Jesus breaking bread with the tax collectors and the other sinners. Jesus responded to the complaints with a series of stories, and they're about real life. He tells a story about a shepherd, and the shepherd's got a flock of sheep, and one of the sheep goes missing. And a sheep is not a big deal to most of us, particularly if we don't have a flock ourselves, but to that shepherd who was probably present when each lamb was born, often in the middle of the night, often in the middle of the winter, that shepherd would have cared about the sheep that was missing, and he did in the story. And he goes out and he keeps searching until he finds that lost sheep. And when he finds that lost sheep, he rejoices because that sheep that was lost has now been found. And then Jesus tells a second story, and it's about a woman who has a coin. And who cares? That's not a big deal on anybody's plate except for the woman for whom that coin might make the difference between feeding her family on the next day or going hungry. And she lost that coin, and she searches all around her house until she finds that lost coin. And when she finally finds it, she rejoices. She's happy over a dumb coin. Who gets happy over a dumb coin? But it's a natural human response. And then Jesus tells another story that has had a profound impact on my life, and I hope it does on yours. It's a story about an ordinary family, an A-list family that probably, if there were a Better Homes and Family magazine in the Jewish time, this family would be a cover story because they're the perfect family. There's a dad, and every Jewish family really hoped to have a man at the head of the household, we know the man was rich, not only because the Bible talks about sort of material possessions later in the story, but it also mentioned he has an heir, a male heir, an elder son, and he has a spare, a younger son, and isn't that fabulous? I have to tell you, I learned some things about this story that I'm going to relate to you from Dr. Kenneth Bailey, the late Dr. Bailey. In 1973 and 1974, after a lifetime of missionary service in the Middle East, he was fluent in Semitic languages, and he spent much of his life working with the people of the Middle East who taught him about their own history and culture and understanding of Scripture. And I was privileged to take a course from Dr. Bailey at the Near East School of Theology on the parables of Jesus from a Near Eastern perspective, and he told us about this family, this perfect, wonderful, on the face of things family. They had a scandal. Can you believe that? Families that have a scandal, that's not all perfect. And in this scandal, what happened was the younger son asked for his share of the inheritance. And that might not mean anything to you, but back then that was horrific. You see, every family has a goel. Goel is Hebrew for the Redeemer, and the oldest male in the family was the goel, and he headed up the household and was responsible for the maintenance of the family and the property and the taking care of the kids and the grandkids. Then the family lived in a community, and the community was responsible for maintaining the property, and there were clear laws and traditions regarding the rights of succession. And in the right of succession of the property, when dad dies, the oldest son becomes the new goel, and all of the property and responsibility falls for caring for the family falls on his shoulder. And if the second son desires to have a life of his own after dad dies, then he would get a smaller share of the inheritance, but it would be incumbent upon him to take that wealth and to preserve it in the context of the larger well-being of the community. What the younger son asks for, and it's really embarrassing when the family skeletons come out of the closet, but what the younger son asks for is he asks for his share of the inheritance, and he wants it early, and essentially he's saying to his older brother, I am never going to live under your rule, and he's saying to his father, I wish you were dead. This father loves his son so much that he does the unthinkable, and he cashes in some of the family assets, which then everybody in the village knows about, and he gives them to his younger son, who leaves town. According to Dr. Bailey, he would have had to leave town, because what he did was a crime not only against the family, but also against the community, and he took the money, and he left. Now, money is a universal language, and as long as you've got it, you can pretty much go anywhere and be accepted. But it's obvious that the younger son has not taken Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University course. And so he takes the money and he lives in an Epicurean fashion. Let's eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we will die, with no concern about investing for tomorrow. And he runs out of money before he's dead. And then he wonders what to do, and he falls into poverty. I learned something that I never forgot about poverty while serving as pastor of this church. With community mental health, I was able to take a tour one day in Grand Rapids, and our tour guide was the pastor of a mega church in Grand Rapids who was hired by that church to be their pastor to the homeless of Grand Rapids. I'll never forget a meeting I had with a member of his parish. It was a man who was college educated, who was a manager of a significant manufacturing firm in Grand Rapids. And he had a good life. He was living the dream. He had a nice house. He had a car. His wife had a car. Everything was going along great until one day he went to work, and the higher-ups in the company decided that they could give a better return to their shareholders if they closed down the Grand Rapids operation and shipped all the jobs to China, which they did. And suddenly, through no fault of his own, he found himself unemployed. And at his age and in that economic environment, he also found himself unemployable. And it doesn't take long when you're not making your mortgage payments for the bank to foreclose on your home. And it doesn't take long when you're not making your payments for the car companies to repossess your automobiles. And it doesn't take long for the unemployment to run out. And when all of those things happen, the pressure on his marriage was such that it just blew apart. And he found himself living in a cardboard box that he'd scavenged from the back of an appliance store. And he had to move that box periodically because he would be evicted when someone would complain about the box where they could see it. And so he was living in a remote section along on public ground near the Grand River. He said, and I'll never forget, when poverty gets you under its thumb, it's very difficult to get back up. He said, you can't get clean. You can't stay warm. Your possessions have to fit in a shopping cart, and you've got to guard it with your life or somebody will rip it off. You have to live within walking distance of the feeding programs where you get the take it or leave it handouts at a time that they designate. I never forget that visit. And the realization that this experience of suddenly being poor can happen to any of us. And when I think about what's going on now in the communities around the United States and the world because people can't go to work, there are an awful lot of people that are in very fragile places. And the Church of Jesus Christ, it's needed now more than ever. Anyway, the younger son fell into poverty, and he found himself doing the only work that he could do, which was tending another man's hogs, which tells you how far he's fallen, because pigs, to a Jew, are unclean animals. They're on the do not go near, do not touch, do not eat list for people who keep kosher dietary laws. Another side here, I learned something about pigs that you should know too. It was a number of years ago, I was pastoring a church in Northwest Illinois. One of my parishioners after church came up to me and said, Pastor Glenn, he said, I need you to do me a favor. I said, well, what's that, Roger? He said, well, my dog's died and I'm so depressed and I haven't been able to bury him. He's out in the back, and I was wondering if you could come to my house and help me with a funeral and a burial for my dog. And that wasn't a course I ever took in seminary, but I said, well, okay, Raj, I think I can do that. And so I went to his house, and we had the funeral for his dog, and Roger still looked depressed. I said, Roger, is there anything else I can do to help you? He said, yes. He said, I haven't been able to clean my hog house in a couple of days, and I wondered if you'd help. And I said, sure. I had never before been in a hog house. I hope never to go again. It was after a couple of days, do you know what? Hog houses get filled with a four-letter word that starts with S, that because we're in church, I'm going to call it slop. And I got in there, and hog slop, it stinks. It is the most disgusting, toxic, noxious smell. It was a struggle to keep from gagging, and I shoveled that hog slop for a couple hours. Do you know that hog slop gets into the pores of your body? It gets into your clothes. And after a couple hours, my body, in self-defense, just shut off my capacity to smell it. Just done. And on the way home from Rogers, it was Christmas time, and I thought I'd forgotten to buy Nancy a present. So I went into the local department store, and I was thinking of some nice jewelry. I went up to the counter at Christmas in a department store at the jewelry counter, and no one, I mean no one, would wait on me, period. I didn't know what the matter was, so I left, and I went home. I walked into the house. Nancy was at the other end of the house, and I heard her cry out, "Where have you been?" And I said, well, I was just out buying your Christmas present, honey. Which brings me back to the hog thing. When you're poor and in the Middle East, and you've been tending the hogs, and you finally decide that you have to go home, because maybe you could live better as a servant of your father than you're living here, where the hogs are eating better than you are. You're carrying the stench with you. And he came home, and the Bible tells us that his father, who I'm guessing had been looking for his son since the day that he left, his father came running to greet him, smell and all. Dr. Bailey said that you need to know that men in the Middle East, particularly goels of established families, do not run in public. It's undignified. But the people of his parish told him why the father would run. Because there would be gangs of teenagers who would have remembered the younger son's crime against his family and the community, who, if they had seen him or smelled him coming, would have greeted him with jeers and stones to drive him away because he was not welcome. And the father wanted to get ahead of that public reaction by placing himself between the ridicule and his son. And his son apologized and asked for a position as a servant in the family, and the father would have none of it. He embraced his son. He loved his son. He took off his own robe and gave it to his son to wear and invited him in and told the servants to kill the fatted calf and have a party and call the entire town together to let them know the good news about this lost son who was restored to the family. Meanwhile, the elder brother is out on the porch. He has come home from working in the fields all day and noticed this big to-do going on, and somebody gave him the word. And in a word, the Bible doesn't say this, this is my paraphrase, he was pissed. And you know, as a kid, I used to think, what a dumb older brother. But I get it now. I get it. Because a younger brother's sin wasn't just against dad. It wasn't just against the community. It was against him and his lawful, rightful place in the family to take over for dad someday. The younger brother was dissing him too. And dad humbles himself again. This family trauma, the community knows all about it. And they see dad leave the party. They know what's going on. He goes out to confront his older son. And he lets the older son vent, because you need to do that. It's justified. And then the dad, again, states the reason for him extending love to this marked brother, the one who easily could have an F for felony on his chest or an SO for sex offender on his chest for having violated the community norms. And then we're left hanging. On television, over the years, I've come to the conclusion that there's a formula. If you're going to produce a successful television show, you have a drama, you have a conflict, and then you have a resolution. And you have the resolution in about a half hour or an hour, and then everybody gets to feel good and happy, and we tune in next time to find out what's going to go on with our heroes. But they don't leave you hanging, except maybe at the end of a season when they want you to come back. But they resolve it, and this parable doesn't resolve it. I need to take a side trip with you here. When I was a kid being raised in a church, I learned that an important part of being a follower of Jesus Christ is that we needed to share his love with others. And the people who really did that well and were lifted up as exemplars in the church were people who were missionaries. And the missionaries would go overseas, and they'd learn a foreign language, and they would reach people who hadn't heard the message of Jesus Christ before in far-off places like Arabia and Africa and China. And missionaries are a good thing. I believe in missionaries. I'm proud to be supportive of missionaries. But of the 2.4 billion people in the world who claim Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, there are, most of them, according to research, have come to a knowledge about Jesus and a decision, personal decision, to follow Jesus with their life and their love, not because of a missionary in a far-off country, but they cross natural bridges, which means that they've come to an awareness of what it means to follow Jesus by people that they know and love already, like a parent, a member of their family, maybe a neighbor, a member of your sports team, a colleague at work, a friend. So the mission field of Jesus, it's out there, but it's also closer to home than we imagine. Experts tell us that we have an effective circle of influence for most of us of about 12 to 15 people. And of those 12 to 15 at any given point in time, there's a pretty good chance some of them are on our list. The story that Jesus is telling isn't just about a dad and two kids in a far-off country. He's talking about our own families and our own neighborhoods and our own associations with people that we're close to. And he leaves the story hanging, I think, on purpose, because the call about what to do about that list It's ours to make. And the one thing that is undeniable, it's uncontestable, is the Father's undying love for all of his children. There aren't any easy answers. Here's where we come to the what's next. I'm hoping that some of you this week will take a tiny step in the direction of loving like Jesus has loved. Sometimes it'll work, sometimes it won't. It takes a lot of prayer, and but I'm hoping that you might take some small steps. One, by thinking about who in my circle of influence, the 12 to 15 people that I know best in my life, who really needs to know the love of Jesus that I can share this week in some form of embodiment, like inviting them out for coffee, just going to listen for a while, inviting them to come with me to church, inviting them to listen to this video because you send them the link from Facebook in an email. Is there somebody there? And maybe you'll take another step, and that there's somebody in that circle of influence that is really on your list, a family member that you haven't talked to for years because they did something that really hurt you badly. Do you have enough courage to want to make another attempt? Or maybe you can't go close to that. You're not ready for that yet. Go to the library and check out a book on conflict resolution and see prayerfully if you can learn some new skills that might help you down the road. All I know is that the one thing that keeps speaking to me from this text, that I hope we never forget, is that the God who is our Heavenly Father and parent in heaven loves you sacrificially, self-effacingly, on the cross loves you, and will never, ever stop. The call is ours to make. Let me offer this benediction. It means a good word. It's a way in which the people of God carry with us a piece of the strength of the gathered community. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves the people who are on the list too. And what we do about that in our own life and witness is our great calling to follow Christ. Go in peace.